Okay, hi everybody. I think we can maybe make a start because I know we've got a lot of exciting visual material to look through tonight. Firstly, thank you very much for coming out on a Friday. Some of our program this term will be on a Friday, most of it will be on a Thursday, but I do appreciate all of you coming to the first event in our Visual Cultures Public Program lecture series on the theme of living extinctions. For those of you who don't know me, my name is Wood Roberto. I'm the head of the Visual Cultures Department, and I co-organized this series with my colleague Lynn Turner, who is on her way. But I maybe wanted to just say a bit about the concept of the program more generally. In the department, each term we have a thematic program that resonates with the research interests or practices of two or more colleagues generally that want to produce something together that's more public-facing like this. That being said, it's also very much geared towards our undergraduate and postgraduate student community, so all of this material can always feed back into your seminar discussions and probably at the pub afterwards. I'll let you know where we decide to go once we have. So for posterity's sake, I wanted to just go through a quick introduction about the theme of living extinctions and give a rationale for why we, along with the generous support of the critical ecologies research stream at Goldsmiths, have been able to produce this series of talks. I'll read through some of the blurb up there, but also add to it. Breaking news, October 2018, the IPCC reports only 12 years to avoid disastrous global warming. April 2019, Extinction Rebellion emerges as a visual force and stages nonviolent city blocking protests. June 2019, the Green New Deal for Goldsmiths petition is signed and circulated. July 2019, students across the world declare a climate emergency and rise up. August 2019, Goldsmiths announces key measures to meet the demands of the GND, followed by a series of rallies against air pollution, environmental racism, and toxicity during Welcome Week that some of you may have come to. In response, the Department of Visual Cultures and the Critical Ecologies Research Stream offer the program of Living Extinctions, in anticipation also of the 2020 UN Climate Summit, or COP26, Council of Parties 26, in Glasgow. From the Latin extinguere, the term extinction languished in its pre-modern usage for the quenching of a flame or the paying of a debt. By the 18th century, however, this mundane description began to take on the ever more vertiginous rhetoric of the wiping out of species. In what many are now identifying as the Anthropocene, a period now witnessing a sixth mass extinction, we're faced with the fact that man's economics and politics are directly entangled with climate collapse, and the rendering of the living earth is uninhabitable for non-human animals and increasingly for ourselves. Yet, as we know, human or carbon footprints are distributed geographically, culturally, and economically, creating diverse degrees of impact that divide the subject Anthropos beyond its vanity point in the global north. Local and global environmental degradations, stockpile civil unrest, deforestation, colony collapse disorder, migration violence, coral bleaching, whales beaching, air pollution, and fracking. This list is not random, not exhaustive, but of course escalating with both systemic and individual losses, often tragic. In her 2014 book, This Changes Everything, Naomi Klein critiques the ubiquitous image of the polar bear on melting ice as a guilt-inducing trope that can freeze us human beings into environmental inaction and despair. This work by the artists Snæbjørn's daughter Wilson will be here later in the term, I think does something else with that image by presenting an accumulation of bodies and certainly through the engagement with institutional critique. We certainly can say that we live with truth and falsehood every day with supersaturated and mediated visual culture. Some might argue that the climate's changed many times before, and they would not be wrong. But now the Anthropos is what is forcing that change towards collapse with and without intent. While eco-modernists might optimistically frame survival and renewal through catastrophic end times, we might ask, are reparative concepts such as rewilding or de-extinction possible or even desirable? If not, how does this affect our cultural production? How best to answer the call for the decolonization of nature itself, by renewing a sense of responsibility to diverse planetary cohabitants, both human and non-human. Can a social contract or culture be extended to what philosopher Michel Serre named a natural contract? He argued for addressing long-term geopoetics alongside short-term politics of conflict and resistance. How do we productively confuse universal causes and particular circumstances? Have we indeed arrived at a movement amongst all movements? When thinking at the temporality of climate crisis, is it not best to understand the present as an ongoing zone of eco-ethical potential, as opposed to relying on utopian visions of a future always in retreat? One of our guests, Farhana Yamin, has argued that all of this is about, more than anything else, ending domination rhetoric of all kinds, environmental, racial, gendered, economic, etc. And with regards to racial environmentalism and global strife, we might conclude that migration has become the only option and will therefore continue to take many forms and directions going forward. So just to sum up, in this series of talks and discussions, we come together as thinkers, practitioners, and students to ask ultimately how we should engage the task of living with extinction in this contemporary and volatile world. So I just wanted to very quickly give you a little bit more of information about who's coming. Kate Davies, obviously, has had to postpone, regrettably, but thankfully, our very own Susan Schuppli, who I'll introduce in a minute, has very kindly stepped in to present her work in progress and to give you an overview of her practice more generally. Kate might return later in the term with her fieldwork interventions called Wild Sites. But next week we have David Ferrier coming from Edinburgh, who's a lecturer in English and Comp Lit, who also leads the Edinburgh Environmental Humanities Network and will be talking to us about poetry in the face of extinction and what its role is culturally. Following that, Farhana Yamin, who I mentioned, a climate lawyer who's maybe been made famous mostly through her arrest and participation with Extinction Rebellion. You can YouTube her being interviewed on the BBC News channels. She'll be coming in to talk to us about that experience and about the rebellion and its context in a more theoretical sense. The very next day, the Friday following Farhana, so this is a back-to-back anomaly, we have Eben Kirksey flying in to talk to us about his anthropological work to do with hope for multi-species after the Anthropocene. And then on Halloween, on the 31st of October, Caitlin Berrigan is joining us. She is an exciting artist, who works with multimedia around the concepts of imaginary explosions and volcanology. So there's a lot of geological interest there, but also in terms of thinking beyond the human and in thinking in terms of different temporalities and subjectivities. Producers of this work, Snabhorn's daughter and Wilson, will follow on the 21st of November to specifically, as far as I understand, focus on this project, Polar Bears Out of Place, but also to introduce their other long-term residency works in local communities, specifically aimed at the relationship between so be presenting his work on the histories and biopolitics of zoos during wartime, which resonates with my colleague Lynn's interest in animal studies. And the last lecture will be a nice coda, I think, to the program, because we have Wahida Kankar coming in, who teaches in philosophy and politics, and her current work has to do with philosophical vitalism, art, and biological morphologies and how they operate in contemporaneity. I've said enough about the program, so I'll introduce Susan now. Susan Schuppli's work examines material evidence from war and conflict to environmental disasters. Creative projects have been exhibited throughout Europe, Asia, Canada, and the US. Recent commissioned works include Learning from Ice at the Toronto Biennial, Nature Represents Itself at Sculpture Center, Trace Evidence at Bilmuseet Umea, and Atmospheric Feedback Loops at Vertical Cinema Project for Sonic Arts Amsterdam. She's published widely within the context of media and politics and is author of the forthcoming book Material Witness from MIT Press. Schuppli is director of the Center for Research Architecture, Goldsmiths University of London, and is an affiliated artist researcher as well as board chair of forensic architecture. And again, I'm very thankful that she was able to come and talk to us tonight. So thank you, Susan.
Great, thank you, Wood. But more importantly, it's wonderful to see so many people here on a Friday evening at Goldsmiths when there's a lot of, like, I think a lot of competition in terms of exciting things you could be doing. I see a number of our new MA students, so that's terrific, and also former MAs. So, yes, I'm a bit of an understudy, if you will, for Kate Davies, and my work, I must say, does not specifically address the Extinction Rebellion. I've been to a couple of events, but maybe some of the ideas will circulate around that area, and we can hopefully maybe try and bring the two together in the Q&A. So the plan is, for me, I thought I would sort of depart from my original plan. I thought I would show a few clips from a very recent project. I finished it a couple of weeks ago, in fact. And I see Safa in the audience. Safa produced music for this project. It's an hour-long documentary called Learning from Ice, Part One, Ice Cores. So this is a new research project I'm working on. It has three components. And the first part is a documentary around ice core science. So working specifically with the scientists who are extracting cores from the Arctic and Antarctic regions of the world in particular, also Greenland, and analyzing them in order to find evidence in particular of global warming such that they can bolster the political claims that need to be made in the face of cataclysmic warming of the planet. But this is really an inquiry into the practices of these scientists and documenting them working with the materials of their research. And it's quite extraordinary to see the sort of practices of care that they've also developed in relationship to these materials. So I'll show a few clips from that. As I said, it's an hour-long project. I'm going into the sound studio again next week. So there's clearly work I need to continue to do with this. So it's considered a bit of a work in progress. It has three phases. As I said, the second part is called Siku Sense. And that will be working with a group of students in the coming year in the Arctic, working with students from Nunavut Arctic College, which is in Canada. And the Siku is an Inuktitut word that means sea ice. And so we'll do a sort of counter mapping projects. And then the third part is called The Right to be Cold. And that is a legal forum, in fact, around the various legal questions that emerge when geographies are undergoing radical thawing and melting. And if we think about the ways in which sovereignties are constituted legally, they always assume a terrestrial condition and a fixed terrestrial condition, in fact. But frozen water isn't entirely land, and it's, as I said, and we are very aware of the fact that it's undergoing dramatic transformation. That throws up a whole set of new legal questions in terms of sovereignty. Certainly has a dramatic impact on indigenous life worlds, is implicated in new extractivist practices because the Arctic is being opened up to new economic incursions, but also transportation routes. So I think an important point of this project, and I'm going to just point out that line, which is about the vanity of, what's that line exactly? In the blurb, it says the vanity point in the global north. One of the things I'm trying to do with this work is in some way is to actually situate it in the north, not the north that is this north here in the UK or that runs along the 49th parallel in Canada, but the actual circumpolar north, because a lot of the discussions around certain anti-colonialist struggles, but also discussions around global warming, climate change, they often turn their attention to the warmest places on the planet and not the actual northern regions of the world in which where we find accelerated warming at four times the kind of global average. So part of the politics of this project is actually to work, as I said, within the circumpolar north and working with communities there, et cetera, et cetera. It's organized pedagogically around this concept of learning. How is it that different stakeholders gather around this material that's very familiar to us that's called ice? You know, and what are the kind of practices of knowledge production that are part of engaging with this material? How do they, how are different claims made? How do they compete? How do they stage their kind of, stage the kind of political arena, et cetera, et cetera. So that's a little bit of an introduction. So I'll show you some clips. We'll just jump through the project. It probably, it's more to give you a sense of the texture, if you will. And then I will unpack some other works to, so beginning with my most recent project, I thought it's interesting for me to maybe also then reflect, how did I get there? And we'll sort of then move through some other projects to hopefully figure that out. Figure that out together, in fact. And I have a bit of a cold, so I'm probably sound a bit stuffy. So Safa, I hope you're gonna be okay with this sound mix. I haven't never played it actually I had to produce a 4-channel sound for the Toronto Biennial, so I've actually never heard this piece with the stereo mix. So I'll be hearing it for the first time too. And I think it'd be nice to turn down the lights. Perfect, thanks. So I'm just going to play, maybe it'll be like 7 minutes from this project at different points. So we'll start at the beginning though. And let me know if you think the volume needs to go up or down. Because I tend to like it nice and loud.
Thank you. In 2011, the Geological Survey of Canada's ice core collection faced an uncertain future. Comprised of more than 1,000 meters of ice drilled from glaciers in the Canadian High Arctic over a period of four decades, the cores and the scientists who worked on them were met with shifting research priorities and budget cuts. The prospect of thousands of years of climate history literally melting away spurred glaciologist Martin Sharp into developing a plan to save and rehouse the collection. Now at the University of Alberta, shelters this unique collection of historic ice. Preserved within these cylindrical tubes.
Yeah, it'll just be a lot of scraping. But these samples actually are quite beautiful.
Yeah.
Ready? Yeah. These are slabbed already. This was the wide diameter drill. We don't even have 30 meters of this, I don't think. I'll have to look at the inventory.
Jump ahead. I think that's Allison Cristello talking, and maybe I did an interview with her. Maybe we'll play a little bit of that. If I can find that. Let's try to. I'll play it. Actually, Allison loves to listen to, actually, she listens to 80s rock, which she actually works in the lab. So this is what she listens to. Anyway, there's Allison. She listens to Boston. But let me get to the beginning, if I can, somehow. Just hear a little bit of Allison.
Precious thing from the past. It just feels
precious presently to me. And maybe that is because I spend a lot of my year living on ice, and it's just such a present place for me. In the Canadian high Arctic, there is no way to get to any field site at all without going through and being with some communities, so it is such a richer experience. And I think the permitting process of getting acceptance from the local community and from Nunavut to work on their land is actually very rewarding to go through. You know that you have the most important permission to be on their land when you go through that process. And I have seen more people do this recently, and I hope it continues. But I think I put in the most effort I can to, for example, go to the local school in any community we go through and spend a half a day just talking about why the heck we're there, what we're doing, and to talk to students and principals of schools, and pretty much just try to interact in whatever meaningful way we can with the communities that we go through. It's their land, and it is a privilege to work on it. I think a lot of people don't presently, you know, you have this like outreach checkbox, and I think a lot of scientists who work in the north just do their bare minimum, but I think it's changing. I can describe.
Maybe that probably have to work a little bit on the sound there to make Ellison a bit more prominent. Maybe another little section. This, let's see what's happening here.
The importance of the ice cores is to preserve history.
Oh no, I think I won't. I'll pop ahead actually, because I did quite a bit of filming in the also at the Athabasca Glacier, which is the image that Ramon circulated, and this is just to give you a sense of the carbon deposits in the ground are, you know, it's one of the world's fastest melting glaciers. So, I mean, there's the Athabasca Glacier. This is the Athabasca Glacier, and this is also part of the Athabasca Glacier. So this is not an Arctic glacier. This is in the Rocky Mountains. I'll jump a little bit ahead. We can see hear a little bit about from the lab.
That can be transported around and then removed from the atmosphere, particularly if it's removed under cold climate conditions, has the potential to be recorded in glaciers and ice sheets, and to produce records of the history of use of those substances. Because the same is true for natural substances too, so you can get records of dust storm activity, examples of dust fallout really near the top of Mount Logan in the Yukon, for instance, where the source of the dust was traced to the Gobi Desert in China. And there's a lot of different facets of things that go on in the environment, both natural and anthropogenic, that the ice cores are effective at detecting and documenting.
The archive is a space of preservation, where cores lie in purposeful wait. Whereas the laboratory is the domain of destruction, the site where ice is cut, crushed, and melted, so that its internal life worlds can be released and studied. At Oregon State University, scientists and students are investigating changes in the chemical composition of air, especially carbon dioxide and methane, searching for atmospheric clues captured in the annual layers of snowfall that have slowly compressed to form polar ice.
So there's a the second half deals with the laboratory, I'll just jump a little bit ahead to the sort of end. So there's maybe here we can meet up with Edward Brooks, who's a very famous climate scientist that works in Antarctica.
We have different apparatus for different gases. Carbon dioxide is obviously really important because it's the most important greenhouse gas. Carbon dioxide also has a property where it dissolves in water quite a bit. So we can't measure it with melting, which is unfortunate because the melting process is pretty simple. What we have to do is actually physically crush or break or somehow break up the ice. We have to do it in vacuum and it has to be cold. There's a piston that's driven up and down and it has some little needles on the end of it, and they crush the ice, it just goes like that, break it up mechanically. The other way is to shine a light on it and sublimate the ice, not so much energy that it melts. And that is a method that's been successful in some labs. We don't do that here, it's a little bit slow. The advantage of doing that is that you get all of the air. When we crush the ice, we're not 100% efficient. We'll leave behind some little bits of ice that still have air bubbles. Normally, that's not a problem. And once that is finished, then we trap the air in a small tube at very cold temperatures and isolate it with a valve.
The gas gets liberated here from the ice, and it travels through this. This is a water trap. So normally we would have a dewar of cold ethanol here. It would freeze out all the water vapor in the sample. And then from here on, you'd have dry air moving through this line, and it would all get frozen into the bottoms of these tubes.
Gas just travels through the right series of valves to get into this instrument. We'll get the CO2 concentration. Challenge is just that we want to make a lot of measurements, so we have to open and close this chamber. See all these bolts. A lot of what we do is just turning wrenches here, and so we can only measure a few samples per day. I think you can see that there's a lot that's involved in making the measurements. So we start out with the piece of ice in the freezer and we look at it and think about it. And sometimes really takes some time to reflect on it because the material is so interesting. Once you get it inside one of our chambers, our objective is essentially to destroy it. We want to get the air out. And all of the ice recedes a little bit from view because we're just now focused on the measurement and so on. But I think when we come back, once we have the data sets, I think our perception changes again, because then we start to realize how unique the result is. We really are laboratory focused. We spend most of our time on the lab end. But collecting samples, I think for Earth scientists, being in the field to collect the samples you're working on is really critical. And also for a lot of us, being able to do that is one of the reasons we like our work. Although we don't spend that much time in the field relative to the time in the lab, it's really important to understand the context that you've collected the sample in. Even if it's a deep ice core that's been drilled for 5 years and 50 people worked on it, it's really important for people to go there and understand how the material came into our hands, how we kept track of the depth, and how certain we were about where it came from, and all kinds of things like that. So everybody that works here gets to spend some time in the field, even if they don't really need to, just to make sure they have the whole picture.
Thank you.
deposit there. So that gives you a bit of a sense of the narrative arc of the project. As I say, beginning in the archive, moving into the laboratory, and those of you who may be familiar with my practice, I've spent a lot of time thinking about this condition of material witnessing, so the ways in which materials furnish information about events. And what is so incredibly unique about the ice core, because in those ice cores, and now the ice core record goes back 800,000 years, it will soon reach a million, but inside those ice cores, we have the ancient air, and actually also ancient microbial life, frozen that is, we have the thing itself. So ice cores are not like tree rings or ocean sediments or coral reefs or stalagmites in caves. All of those others, phenomena are considered, they're considered data proxies. They offer indirect ways of measuring temperature, precipitation from previous century and, you know, and even eras. So, but in the ice core archive, what you have are tiny bubbles of air, that ancient air, and in that air can tell us, in particular, can tell us about greenhouse gases. And it's sort of irrefutable proof that the levels of CO2, methane, etc., are no longer operating or being produced according to the sort of kind of like cyclical variation that you might see in the ice core. So I also became interested in the ice cores, not just because it's a kind of, because I really wanted to do work in the north and return to Canada, which is the place that I'm from, but also because here was a kind of paradigmatic material witness that could actually offer incredible kind of information in a very kind of high resolution. It's a very high resolution archive as well. But also the way that the scientists, of course, engage with these materials in our contemporary context, these are data sets, these are information. There's a really kind of strong language around treating these things as kind of media objects. So they're not simply like organic matter. They're actually always sort of referred to as carriers of information. And that's, so the terminology moves very fluidly from, say, areas of culture and media to the techno-scientific. But it's also really important to remember that an ice core might be the object of scientific inquiry, but very quickly it becomes a technical object and ultimately a social object, because these are the objects that become discursive. They start to move in policy debates around around whatever, global warming, CO2 emissions, et cetera, so the ice core status as a material object certainly isn't fixed. And I'd probably argue that its contemporary sort of reality is largely as a discursive object and something that is always entering into the field of policy making. So just to close this quick time, I will bring up my keynote. So I called the presentation Earth Evidence. Is it okay if I continue in the dark like this? Because it probably makes more sense in terms of the visuals. And, yeah, you don't really need to see me that well. So how did I get to that project? I wanted to begin with the... This image of the electromagnetic spectrum, because in some way the project really begins with the provocations to a large degree of actually nuclear evidence. And those of you, I'm sure you, if you've been watching like whatever the Chernobyl series, you might recognize that that's the stack from reactor unit 4 at Chernobyl, and that's obviously a Geiger counter. And Ellie Carpenter is here still, I assume, and she's like a leading expert on all things nuclear, certainly at Goldsmiths, and I encourage you to seek out Ellie if you're interested in this area. And we have a number of events coming up, actually this month, in fact. But I brought up that electromagnetic spectrum because, in part, the provocation of a lot of environmental harms, lots of different forms of violence are not necessarily organized around the thresholds of human perception. While we could say like environmental pollutants, contaminants that often take years to metastasize, to move through different sort of ecological systems, their effects can be very dispersed, they may not reveal themselves for sort of decades. So that's a kind of permanent condition of environmental violence. But certainly other things like Ramon is here, algorithmic violence is also not operating according to the thresholds of kind of human perception or visibility, financial crimes, there's a lot of contemporary harms that don't necessarily present themselves to us in ways that are kind of explicitly kind of visible. And even the scientist in the film, he's saying very quickly that ice recedes from view. It enters into the apparatus. It undergoes all manner of transformation in order to kind of extract information. So I wanted to really focus on that. And there was an interesting prompt, I guess, made by this American environmentalist, Aldo Leopold, and he argued that we can only be ethical in relationship to that which we can see. And it's something I've thought about a great deal because the world that we operate in within the, say, Center for Research Architecture, we're very aware of the role of images in human rights work and in advocacy campaigns, the necessity continually to produce a kind of image or a representation of an event to mobilize action, to mobilize intervention, to produce an empathic response. So the conditions of visibility are extremely important, but they're also, I think, an important critical conceptual kind of turning point in my project that really begins, as I said, with the nuclear. This is a project, I'll play a little bit and talk over it, called Delay Decay.
Все вы знаете, недавно нас постигла беда. Авария на Чернобыльской атомной электростанции.
So we have Gorbachev there giving his address to the Soviet Union on May 15th. Chernobyl happened on April 26, 1986. And in this vitrine, what I have are the front pages of Pravda from the day that Chernobyl happened to the date that Mikhail Gorbachev finally went public with this kind of massive disaster in the Ukraine, in the former Soviet Union. And so the piece simply looks at this temporal delay or this temporal gap. And I argue that it's within those 19 days that one can read the entire politics of the event of Chernobyl. So that installation actually, strangely enough, is for the first time, it's actually now, it's being presented in Kiev as we speak. So you saw that image of the Geiger counter, which of course is a sort of paradigmatic instrument for measuring radioactive contamination. This is a much more recent instrument. It's a gamma camera, and what we're looking at is a gamma sensor inside Fukushima Daiichi, and so this is a camera that was designed by Toshiba specifically to visualize radiation. I'll show you a little bit of a clip of how some Japanese scientists have been using it fairly recently.
One scientist involved in these investigations is Satoshi Mori. Mori and his team use a special camera that can show a visualization of the radiation dose. The areas with the highest levels appear in red. It's clear the amount of radiation near the ground is particularly high. Hotspots with exceptionally high levels of radiation are scattered throughout the forest.
As LA could certainly tell you, the kind of classic Geiger counter produces very highly localized sort of readings, these sort of, you know, that syncopated sound that we're so familiar with. One of the major innovations of this camera is allows you to detect radiation contamination in very wide open environments. And I was intrigued with this camera, and I went to Toshiba to ask if I could somehow work with it. The answer was, of course, a resounding no, because I'm a non-expert, and they're not going to give this kind of equipment to somebody who might say, first of all, you know, is not specifically trained to use it and might actually produce some sort of hysterical kind of moment if I'm finding radiation spike somewhere, for example. This is the kind of response that I received, and it's an extremely expensive camera as well. But I was actually keen to take it into environmental systems, because at the time it had just been used inside the failed reactors. So, but I was then interested when this documentary came out several years after I had produced my own work. And these scientists sort of did what I had been hoping to do. So as I gave myself liberty to produce my own gamma camera graphics. And so I did work with that motif in the film that I produced called Trace Evidence. And it's a trilogy that looks at three different events of nuclear evidence. And I'm going to show you, I will show you a couple clips from two of the episodes. So this first one is from the Oklo deposits in Gabon. So the first episode is called Geology, and to some degree looks at kind of the history of uranium mining in Africa.
Uranium mining continued throughout southeastern Gabon until 1999, when the economic viability of extraction shifted. Oklo's deposits only lasted until 1985, after which time its waste rock was left to languish. Futile efforts to curtail uranium dust and the extensive leaching of contaminants from the region's many tailing ponds led to the damming of the Matembe River. Trace evidence of its ancient nuclear legacy has since reappeared, but not as a dangerous latency attributable to the cosmic alchemy of early Earth, but rather to that of industrial mining practices. For 40 years, Comof, a subsidiary of the French nuclear giant Areva, mined uranium in southern Gabon. The operation has had serious consequences for the health of the workers and locals. Many former miners, both Gabonese and French, have died of lung cancer. Under pressure from NGOs, Areva opened a medical clinic last October. But the staff here don't all have the training or resources to properly diagnose diseases linked to uranium mining.
Ça fait plus de 30 ans. Plus de 30 ans qu'on a ce problème.
Longtemps, depuis que Comif existait. A legacy of colonialism and unnatural resource extraction expressed within the damaged ecosystems of the region and the cellular defects of mine workers and local inhabitants. At Oklo, a lethal archive once etched into its ancient geology now reemerges within the biopolitical strata of matter.
Cette carrière aujourd'hui, elle est remplie d'eau. Et lorsqu'on a démantelé l'ancienne usine de la nouvelle, tous les déchets ont été rejetés. Donc tout ce qui a servi à construction de l'usine, le fer, les engins de mine, tout a été jeté à l'intérieur de cette carrière.
Tous les déchets venaient des usines. Tous les travaux de la digue ont duré au moins 2 ou 3 ans, parce que c'est bien avant la fermeture de l'usine qu'on a fait ça. C'était pour faire disparaître les traces.
So I'm not going to show you a clip from meteorology which deals with Forsmark in Sweden, which is where the contaminants for Chernobyl were discovered. We're going to jump to 2011 to the final part of the trilogy called Hydrology, which deals with the contaminants from Fukushima Daiichi. This is actually the only image we have of the accident. It's a webcam, so it never had any sound.
Radioactive materials into the air and water had begun. While Chernobyl's fallout would eventually spread across extensive tracts of arable land throughout Europe, Fukushima's contamination seems to have traveled further still, crossing some 7,600 kilometers through the vast microbial channels of the Pacific, reaching the western shores of British Columbia many years later.
Traces of radioactivity from the nuclear accident in Japan 4 years ago have washed up on Canada's coastline. It's the first time they've detected materials from the accident in North America, but they say the amounts don't pose a threat to living creatures.
So yeah, those are these two events where a certain form of nuclear kind of evidence emerged. And then of course, there is a trial. So the Fukushima trial, which is still ongoing, was very different than the trial that was held for Chernobyl. So here we have three of the most senior figures in the TEPCO management, the Tokyo Electric Power Company management. So that is actually a very significant kind of difference, where the chain of responsibility and presumable kind of criminal liability has actually turned towards senior management. With the case of Chernobyl, of course it was lower level engineers working in the plant at the time, and what was quite extraordinary was the fact that the trial took place in the exclusion zone, which was mandated by Russian law at the time, but it fulfilled the dual purpose of actually, in effect, closing off the trial to public scrutiny and press coverage, because you had to enter into the exclusion zone, which is the zone of kind of maximal contamination. This trial was held a year later. These people were found guilty. Those who died were forgiven for their misdeeds by the judge. And as you can imagine, this was met with a lot of hostility by the public, because the accident was and responsibility for the accident seemed to be completely kind of relinquished, and the so-called theory of a few bad apples was operating. So what we have here is, this is a protest in Kiev, and what I was particularly interested in, of course, because a big part of my practice has been looking at legal forms in relationship to the evidentiary materials, and the fact that the protesters are carrying a sign saying, "We demand a Nuremberg trial for Chernobyl." So if we think about this, in 1987, the really kind of paradigmatic court for putting a state on trial at that time was Nuremberg, and this sort of public demand for a trial that would actually indict the state, I think, was a very kind of powerful message. So I thought I would show a couple of clips from an earlier documentary called Material Witness, where I was first trying to develop the sort of thesis of the material witness, which would, I'll just talk over this. It takes us into the archives of the...
On the 26th of March, my camera had been burned.
This is not my footage. It takes us into the archives of the International Criminal Tribunal for the former Yugoslavia. And what we're seeing here, this is the evidence archive. So all the evidential materials that go into the court are stored here. It actually looks rather ad hoc, and in fact it is rather ad hoc. I mean, boxes are labeled with post-it notes indicating priority evidence. So all of the x-rays from the Srebrenica massacre, they're all labeled with post-it notes, for example. So it's... despite being a very high-level international UN trial, the archive was, to my mind, when I was in there, still sort of slightly shambolic, but at the very least, it was quite, I wouldn't say disorganized, it was a repurposed insurance building, and it was quite idiosyncratic in that the archivists developed their own sort of filing system for, so M was Mostar, O was Amarska, S was Srebrenica, etc. I produced a documentary that looked at two incidents of historical genocide, actually, well, they're not technically legally genocide, but two historic massacres that were caught on tape. One, a VHS tape, and another that was caught on camera many years later, a decade later, in another ethnic conflict, this time in Sri Lanka. So the project looks at these two ethnic conflicts where there was a media artifact that emerged and tries to track these media artifacts, one which ultimately makes its way into an international tribunal, and the other that has never been dealt with because there's never been any kind of war crimes forum that has unfolded in Sri Lanka. The regime is largely still in place. And so this is this moment where I was really trying to think through the ways in which materials capture, archive, and harbor sort of evidence of external events, and what are the means by which we can, those materials then can be sort of mobilized to produce different forms of testimony. How do those materials enter into various sort of public spheres to make a kind of claim? So we'll just look at the sort of opening few minutes of that documentary. Oh, here, sorry, this is an image from the mobile phone footage from Sri Lanka. So another person was also documenting, someone documenting this massacre, which remains unsolved, but is clearly a kind of war crime. Oh, sorry, something happened. Let me just play that again. Yeah, I guess also, I realized it myself.
What does it mean to stand in the place of death? Knowing violent things happened, right here, but seeing apparently nothing. No trace effects, no signs of struggle, no visible residue to alert us to what transpired. We balance our camera on a makeshift tripod, pull focus, and zoom into the distance, scouring the point at which landscape meets the horizon lines of history. Why does the camera perform its acts of image capture with such unblinking confidence when we ourselves are still hesitant? Unsure that we are looking in the right place or in quite the right way? Despite the camera's capacity to confront scenes of horror with perfunctory ease, we do not release our machines entirely to the operations of automated vision. We are still convinced that set to manual will bring us into contact with the event if we recalibrate the intensity with which we look. The camera's task is to record, ours to see into the depth of historical shadows. There are machines that saw these events unfold, but from such a distance that only the scale of mass violence was registered by the pixelated mesh through which single bodies slipped, disappearing into the mathematical ether of satellite resolution. We used these machine-made images to find our way here, in landscapes where territories and maps have changed hands and names, the fluctuating nomenclatures of ethnic conflict. We pull off by the side of...
I think I'll stop that, because just what I wanted to say about that project was, through the various sort of chapters, that we start to see the ways in which there's a kind of conjunction between media, different kinds of, say, matter that operates in a, to sort of record an event or a violation. So, you know, technical media, but also the ways in which the landscape itself. So, I should have played a little bit more, but the ways in which there's a certain kind of semiotics that one can read if you understand what it is that you're sort of looking at, what it is that you're sort of seeing, which is often a consequence of, you know, situated kind of local knowledge, etc. So these, and as I said, also trying then to follow the kind of evidential trail that in one case would lead to the ICTY, in the other case, would only ever, the media only ever circulated in the kind of courts of public opinion, if you will, and that's the place where that sort of, that artifact had the kind of greatest, let's say, political kind of traction, but certainly not with any sort of legal context. I think I'll just make a bit of a jump cut in my presentation. I'll just play this little, it's not a very interesting animation, but at the same time, what I have also been interested in is looking at the ways in which different kinds of situations of toxicity and pollution in particular, the ways in which they are actually operating according to a certain kind of technicity. So maybe what we might call a kind of like a form of kind of natural media, if you will. And certainly those of you who might be familiar with the sort of, with chemical photography, it's that process has a direct analogy, for example, to processes of photosynthesis in the, you know, energetic quanta from the sun is involved in a kind of chemical reaction that ultimately ends up producing a kind of visible surface effect. So there's a strong correlation, and it's certainly not my my observation. This is something that has been, was discussed quite frequently, in particular kind of in the 19th century, as new forms of kind of technical media and recording were kind of emerging. So there's a lot of analogies to be made to kind of existing kind of processes, but also things like the flashes from lightning, for example. That moment of kind of intense illumination was the direct sort of precursor to understanding the role of the flash in a photographic regime. I mean, it very directly inspires that technical kind of development. So I was interested in this conjunction. And in particular, oil spills, because oil spills technically are called oil films by scientists, and the behavior of hydrocarbon atoms when they interact with water produces a kind of a parabolic effect. It refracts light in a very kind of particular kind of way, such that we get these kind of hallucinogenic kind of colors that emerge. And that film of oil is an actual, that is a film, and of course the origins of celluloid film are themselves derived from petroleum-based kind of products. So I wanted to produce a work that could somehow tell this story, if you will. And so the Deepwater Horizon in the Gulf of Mexico seemed a very useful one to work with, in part because of, in part because there's also an important dimension and interest in my practice, which has been looking at the kind of media response, or the ways in which media is always operating in the context of these events. So what we have here is that these are all the wells that are operating in the Gulf of Mexico. So there's over 3,000. So Deepwater Horizon is one of 3,000 potential accidents that could happen at any time. So it's important to remember that entire Gulf is completely saturated with this kind of technology. And at the time, there was a very strident media ban on the part of British Petroleum. So these kinds of images were seen because they're images that were produced, that were sanctioned by BP. This is an image taken by kind of US Coast Guard. There are other sort of image responders to the event. This is the underwater video stream. That was another form of sort of automated vision, if you will. So there was the underwater camera, and there was also, I've got permission from Public Lab to produce this large image. This is an image from the activist group Public Lab that emerges at that time, precisely as a response to the fact that there was this kind of total media ban on the part of the industry to kind of block access to the spill. In effect, containing the media the spill could be contained, but there was certainly very kind of significant efforts made to contain the media cycle. And this is the kind of, so these are the kind of images that Public Lab would develop, and AL just popped into the room. Are you still here? Yeah. And certainly Ariel Kane, one of the researchers, a former PhD student, but a forensic architecture researcher, has used this sort of kite mapping. It's a very low-tech DIY sort of system of aerial photography. They've used that extensively in various projects in the Negev, et cetera, et cetera. So if you're interested in this kind of work, definitely you can look at public labs, DIY websites, and also the work, of course, of forensic architecture. But I extracted that image and turned it into an object, if you will, in the gallery. As I said, there was underwater footage that, of course, BP wasn't in a position to control. Landsat images, these Earth observation satellites that are also capturing images of the kind of expansion of the spill across the Gulf of Mexico. And then my argument was really that there was an image that nobody was actually taking into account, which was the spill itself. That the spill was also in some way documenting the event, because that's exactly what it is. The oil spill is, as I said, it's a form of media, and it was engaged in, at least this is my argument, engaged in documenting its own kind of damaged condition. And this case is really was really important because it was also inspired by the work of Paulo Tavares, a former PhD in the center, and in the book Forensics that was produced, he actually writes about the Deepwater Horizon oil spill and the fact that Ecuador, which has a Pachamama constitution, actually filed a lawsuit on behalf of the rights of the sea against British Petroleum. And so I thought this is a very interesting conjunction, because the legal argument was being made that nature had sort of legal agency, and I wanted to also forward a kind of related argument to talk really about the ways in which environmental systems have also forms of aesthetic kind of agency. So this allowed me to bring those two together. And this, what we have here, this is actually a computer. It's a CGI simulation. So what you can do in certain kinds of software that model fluid dynamics, you can assign the very specific attributes of different kinds of particles, different kinds of hydrocarbon atoms in effect. So I was able to assign the exact same attributes of viscosity, et cetera, that the particular crude oil had in the Gulf, and then unleash that in a computational system and have the computer sort of self-generate the sort of image. So it was the closest that I could get to trying to produce a work. I didn't want to represent the spill. I wanted to produce some sort of condition of a sort of where the image was being made, the image was making itself, if you will. So this was sort of my solution. And then I also had, so there's the CGI simulation, and it has a certain ambient soundtrack. I've just produced a little crude composite here for the purposes of the presentation. And then I also have, if you put on the headphones, you would hear the legal suit as well at the sort of same time. So I'll just play a couple of minutes of that. So this, as I said, this is a composite. So you wouldn't have sort of heard it in quite the same way. Either you have the sort of ambient soundtrack and this sort of CGI animation, or you can hear the kind of legal trial, or the legal suit rather.
Quito, Ecuador, 26th of November, 2010. The Honorable Secretary General, Constitutional Court of Ecuador. Lawsuit on behalf of the rights of nature under the principle of universal jurisdiction. Under the principle of universal jurisdiction, we, Vandana Shiva, an Indian national, member of the Research Foundation for Science, Technology and Ecology, Ana Luz Valadez, a Mexican national, member of Desarrollo Alternativo, Diana Murcia, a Colombian national, member of the Instituto de Estudios Ecologistas del Tercer Mundo, Blanca Chancoso, a Quechua Ecuadorian national, member of the Guarinari, Cecilia Cherez, member and president of Acción Ecológica, Nimo Basi, a Nigerian national, member of the Oil Watch Network, Delfín Tenezaca, a Quechua Ecuadorian national, member and president of the Guarinari, Alberto Acosta, an Ecuadorian national, and Líder Gongora, an Ecuadorian national, member and president of Sea Condemn, hereby submit in defense of the rights of the sea, understood as an integral part of nature, which the Ecuadorian Constitution of 2008 recognizes as a subject of rights, and which we recognize as a giver of life, of which we form part, the present lawsuit filed under the principle of universal jurisdiction against the transnational corporation British Petroleum PLC, headquartered in the United Kingdom, as the responsible party for the environmental disaster that struck the Gulf of Mexico on the 20th of April 2010.
I recently remade that as a series of sort of billboards in downtown Vancouver, but so that was really an experiment to see whether I could make this conceptual argument through I've written about it, but could I actually make that through a series of kind of artistic moves in my art practice? Because you might have also noticed that I had previously used a lot of voiceover narration to make some of the kind of points that I wanted to communicate to the sort of listener and the viewer. So it was also an attempt to sort of pull back from that sort of explicit narration and see whether all of the different elements of the installation could somehow start to produce that kind of conceptual argument that I was making around the sort of self-imaging capacities of some of these kind of environmental systems. I'm going to close. I'll just leave the image up. As I said, it's a shame you missed all of the clips from my latest project.
I'm coming.
But I'm going to put them up so that we have time for the Q&A. I'll just leave some of this image from the Learning from Ice project, and there's another image of a close-up detail of an ice core. So. As I was saying at the very beginning, you know, the ways in which scientists are using these kinds of materials to read the deep time of planetary kind of change. And here we see a sediment layer. But these are also, you know, tiny air bubbles captured in ice. And if you think about, in most contexts, you have you would have two layers of sort of precipitation or sort of snowfall. But a core that's 800,000 years old, by the time you get to the very, very bottom, those layers are extremely kind of compressed, right? At the very top, maybe a meter represents 100 years. By the time you get to the very bottom, a millimeter could be 1,000 years, in fact. But inside these cores, these whole kind of worlds exist. And ice cores, they're not just objects for dealing with the kind of like ancient history or moving backwards in kind of time. They've also been used to look at things like the lead, for example. Lead disappears in the ice core record. In the 1970s, most countries started to pass environmental regulations governing the use of leaded gasoline. So lead drops off dramatically in the ice core record. In the 80s, it virtually disappears because all atmospheric contaminants, regardless of where they happen in the world, end up in the ice core record. So in the 80s, the disappearance of lead then becomes a kind of proof that says, well, in fact, environmental regulatory regimes do work. Another interesting thing about ice cores is like every atmospheric nuclear test that has ever taken place is registered in the ice core. And so the Limited Test Ban Treaty came into effect in 1963. And so in 1963, you have this kind of global ban on atmospheric nuclear testing. So what that meant was all of the nations who were doing that unleashed a final sort of barrage of atomic tests just before the test ban treaty went into effect. So you have this really intensive radioactive signature in the ice. And that signature of 1963 allows scientists to calibrate every single ice core in the world. Like when you find 1963 in ice, that's your baseline calibration, and you can sync up all of your other cores. So that, you know, ice cores contain these really kind of fascinating histories. Some historians are using them to look at the rise and fall of like the Roman Empire, because there was a lot of lead smelting that was happening at the time. Lead has since reappeared very, very recently. Suddenly lead is back, and that tells us there's some infractions happening, and the current thinking is that lead contaminants are likely coming from sort of Southeast Asia. So the really kind of significant thing about ice cores is that anything that goes into the atmosphere, it doesn't matter where it is in the world, will end up in the ice core record, because all atmospheric phenomena circulates globally. In the course of the year, everything will be globally kind of distributed. So it's an interesting kind of material, because you could be in the high Arctic or Antarctic, you could be in the two poles, and you're actually reading information about events that took place in the Sahel, a dust storm, for example. So I'm going to leave it there, and I'm happy to answer any questions that you might have.